Great. So I'm going to start by introducing myself, and then I'll let Claire give a brief introduction before we get into this training that we're calling Big Organizing in the Time of Bernie's Political Revolution. So my name is Winnie Wong. I am one of the co-founders of People for Bernie, which is a social movement, not dissimilar to the 15M movement here in Spain. And we were the people on the outside of the campaign who created a really a historical insurgent campaign against the opposition. We consider them to be the opposition.
Winnie es cofundadora de People for Bernie, que es un movimiento social, dice que es parecido en espíritu al 15M, que ha tenido un papel muy destacado a la hora de hacer organización digital en la campaña de Bernie Sanders en 2016.
We were also the people who are credited with creating the hashtag #FeelTheBurn, which did turn Bernie into a global meme.
Sí, fueron las creadoras del logo Feel the Burn, que fue uno de los, digamos, logos, el hashtag online que más más popular cuando estaba Bernie en campaña. Ella es la autora.
And a lot of what we're going to be talking about in this session is really for the leaders in your party and also the organizers and staff to understand why it's critical now in this very short amount of time to start organizing in a big way and to start using the tools and platforms that we have at our disposal in order to scale the meme, the narrative, the message, and also to make sure that we're using this time to make the right appeals to the people who support your party and who might support your party and who will support your party.
Sí, bueno, el objetivo de esta charla es, digamos, dejar una idea clara tanto a la gente de cuadros y dirigentes del partido como podemos hacer estrategias de comunicación y de organización a escala grande que nos permitan aprovechar, pues eso, la ventana de oportunidad que tenemos, el momento presente para expandir nuestras posibilidades, no solo aquí, sino en otros países también.
So with this, I'll turn it over to Claire.
Thanks. My name is Claire Sandberg, and I was the digital organizing director on the Bernie campaign. So I was on the inside of the campaign, and my job, along with a few other people, was to take the kind of grassroots movement and the chaos that Winnie and others were creating on the outside, and harness it and ask people to do the work to win the voters and make sure that they turned out to vote for Bernie by empowering volunteers, creating structures that allowed volunteers to organize on their own without direct relationships with staff. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm going on too long.
Chris Anderier, la organizadora digital de la campaña de Bernie Sanders, y en esa posición digamos que su misión era en gran medida traducir todo el entusiasmo que se estaba generando a nivel social y de activismo de base que estaba movilizando gente como Winnie y canalizarlo a la estructura de una campaña y crear organizaciones y redes que permitan a la gente en grupos pequeños de activistas o digamos trasladar ese entusiasmo a una serie de resultados electorales y que fueran útiles en las primarias, en las elecciones.
Yeah, so we inside the campaign took the energy and grassroots enthusiasm that was coming out organically of all over the country and asked people to both donate money so that we could run a campaign and ask them to be leaders in that campaign.
Digamos, el gran reto era canalizar todo ese entusiasmo que existía para dos funciones principales. Una es que la gente quisiese donar a escala de microdonaciones para la campaña de Bernie y al mismo tiempo que adquiriese ellos también un perfil propio y que pudiesen liderar ellos iniciativas que tuviesen que ver con la campaña. Es decir, que no solo que donasen, sino que participasen de forma activa y en posiciones de liderazgo a nivel regional.
Great. You want to move the slide to the main slide of the banner? Okay. Okay, great. So we're just gonna we're gonna get started now. And because this is being recorded, we're going to be a little bit more anodyne and not as engaging in the audience because there aren't that many people here. So this is really for your party leaders to review.
Bueno, vamos a empezar ya, y que el formato va a ser un poco más serio y anodino, porque como lo están grabando y esto lo podemos usar para más adelante, pues lo van a adaptar un poco a esas necesidades.
Okay. So, what we did last year and the year before in America, I think, was historical for many reasons. We created a campaign where 15 million people voted for an open socialist. That was not easy to do, given the fact that for many, many decades in America, there has been this anti-socialist sentiment, and everything was stacked against us, from our media to our political systems to our just people who just had this real fear of the word socialism and a deep misunderstanding of what is socialism and how our democracy had really been compromised for the last 50 years. And so we came together in a moment and created this, I think, a transformative political movement that involves all of the people in Podemos and all of the parties in the European left and all of the global left parties around the world now, who are really fighting during this time to really stave off austerity, which is coming quickly.
Bueno, digamos que la campaña de Bernie Sanders fue una campaña sin precedentes, en la medida en que consiguió que 15 millones de personas en Estados Unidos votase a un candidato socialista, con lo que es la palabra socialista en Estados Unidos, que tiene estigma inmenso, y teniendo en su contra pues, a los grandes grupos de comunicación, los aparatos de tanto el Partido Republicano como el propio Partido Demócrata, y digamos que todos los poderes estructurales del país alineados en contra. Lo hicieron además concienciando a la gente de una serie de problemas estructurales de la democracia estadounidense, y realmente generaron un movimiento que se puede comparar a otros movimientos en otros países, pues como Podemos o como está ocurriendo en Reino Unido, que son movimientos que luchan contra la austeridad y que también plantean un reto al status quo.
And like we said at Occupy Wall Street, all of our grievances are connected and another world is possible.
Este era también el eslogan de Occupy Wall Street, de todas nuestras reivindicaciones están conectadas y hay otro mundo que es posible.
The economics of market capitalism have failed us, have failed the people.
Sí, no, todo esto viene de la idea de que el sistema económico del capitalismo del mercado ha fracasado.
Right. And Hillary Clinton lost the presidential campaign to Donald Trump. It wasn't that Bernie didn't win, it was that Hillary Clinton lost. And this is where we begin our journey now of big organizing against everybody.
Sí, el resultado de las elecciones no es que las ganase Donald Trump, sino que las perdió Hillary Clinton, y digamos que aquí es un poco donde empieza la saga de construir organizaciones y realmente crear infraestructura de cara al futuro en Estados Unidos.
So in this section of our talk, Claire and I worked, you know, very hard to try to compartmentalize what we know into a 90-minute presentation. And in this section of the talk, we want to talk a little bit about where we are now politically in the United States.
Muy bien. Esta presentación ha compartimentalizado, digamos, un poco lo que nos quieren hacer aprender durante los siguientes 90 minutos, y van a empezar por la situación de Estados Unidos ahora mismo.
So Donald Trump is our president, and he has filled his cabinet positions with demagogues, oligarchs, billionaires, and vulture capitalists.
Bueno, sí, Donald Trump es presidente y la administración la tiene llena de, bueno, una serie de sinvergüenzas, multibillonarios, especuladores, lo mejor de cada caso.
And they are supported by a Republican party apparatus that is well organized, coordinated, well funded, and efficient.
Pero que tienen el apoyo del aparato republicano, que es una máquina que a día de hoy está bien engrasada, que es eficiente y que tiene unas prioridades claras y bien definidas.
They have all fallen in line behind Donald Trump.
Sí, todos han alineado con Donald Trump. En la campaña hicieron algunos gestos de intentar rechazarle, pero al final han seguido su agenda.
And Donald Trump is not the boss. It's very important to remember this.
Perdona, Trump no es el que manda. Esto es importante recordarlo.
We're at a time now where the people in charge of all of the shadow financial institutions in the world are calling the shots and deciding what democracy must look like.
Estamos en la circunstancia en que al final son las instituciones financieras operando en la sombra las que deciden cuál va a ser la agenda y quién tiene que seguirle cómo.
And Trump's administration is making moves to take away everything from Americans. And when I mean everything, I mean air, water, social security, healthcare, and their homes.
Sí, la administración Trump está intentando desmantelar las pocas protecciones que tienen, sociales que tienen los americanos en todos los ámbitos de la vida, es decir, desde regulación medioambiental, agua, infraestructura, sanidad, trabajos, educación.
And the Democratic Party is not the party that we are looking to help us regain control and build democracy.
Sí, en esta situación el Partido Demócrata no es un partido al que puedas mirar y encomendarte para que realmente no solo hagan oposición a Trump, sino que planteen una agenda que sea inspiradora y ayude a retomar un poco.
The party is badly demoralized. The leadership inside the party is badly demoralized.
El partido está demoralizado y los líderes también están desmoralizados.
The brand is very bad.
Sí, la propia marca del Partido Demócrata sigue teniendo una valoración muy negativa en Estados Unidos.
The apparatus employs incompetent functionaries.
Sí, el aparato del Partido Demócrata está lleno de funcionarios incompetentes.
They spent $1 billion and they lost to Donald Trump.
Sí, gastaron $1,000 millones y perdieron contra un candidato bastante débil como era Donald Trump.
You spent $4 million and you won 5 million votes and you came from a park.
Nosotros no gastamos $4 millones, ganamos 5 millones de votos y veníamos de un parque.
And Pablo won't cut his hair.
Y Pablo no se corta el pelo.
You're winning.
Estamos.
So it's a real crisis of liberal democracy.
Sí, es una verdadera crisis de la democracia liberal.
But there is hope.
Pero hay esperanza.
The Bernie Sanders grassroots people are in many ways extremely chaotic, extremely passionate. And when we say the Bernie Sanders grassroots people, we're not talking about 2,000 or 3,000 people or 5,000 people occupying a park. We're talking about millions and millions of people in America now who have lost confidence in the Democratic Party and who are looking for a place to stand, for an umbrella, a canopy, a signifier, a tent to stand under.
Los activistas que apoyan a Bernie Sanders son gente muy comprometida y con mucha pasión por lo que hacen, pero no estamos hablando de 2,000 o 3,000 personas, sino realmente de millones de votantes que además se han movilizado como activistas y que no encuentran una casa en el Partido Demócrata y no se sienten cómodos con los planteamientos del Partido Demócrata.
Bernie is the most popular politician in America and he is beloved particularly by young people in the country.
Sí, Bernie ahora mismo es el político más popular de Estados Unidos y sobre todo arrasa entre la gente joven.
A 74-year-old old white man from Vermont managed to win 81% of the youth vote. So people under the between the ages of 18 and 28 voted overwhelmingly for Bernie Sanders.
Sí. De las edades de 18 y 28 años, el 81% del electorado votó a un señor mayor blanco de Vermont.
And so we there is hope because in 2020, 90 million of these people, 90 million more young people in America, which is a much bigger country than Spain, will be eligible to vote.
90 million. El electorado de cara a 2020 en esa franja de edad son 90 millones en un país como Estados Unidos, con lo cual es una demográfica bastante esperanzadora.
And so those of us in the United States who are doing politics professionally, such as Claire and I, we're really thinking a lot about many, many things, including how to harness all of this energy behind Bernie Sanders into something that will actually work.
A nivel organizativo el reto para gente como Winnie Claire es, digamos, todo este potencial de gente que quiere votar, cómo se puede canalizar en realmente un efecto de aquí a 2020.
And even though I have spent the last 5-10 minutes talking shit about the Democratic Party,
aunque ha pasado los últimos 10 minutos cagándose en el Partido Demócrata,
I'm not suggesting that anybody in the United States start a third party, and I'm going to tell you why.
Lo que ella sugiere no es que ahora se forme un tercer partido político en Estados Unidos, y nos va a explicar por qué.
It's very difficult constitutionally to make it work.
Sí, constitucionalmente y a nivel de leyes electorales es muy difícil hacer que funcione.
There is a federal fusion party in the United States called the Working Families Party. They have done incredible work over the past decade, and they've only managed to get on just over a dozen party ballot lines, just over a dozen states onto the ballot line. Yeah.
Sí, el Partido de las Familias Trabajadoras es un partido que lleva bastantes años en activismo y un trabajo muy bueno, y solo han conseguido presentar candidaturas en una docena de estados del país.
And so, in the South, where voter suppression laws are in place, it becomes even more challenging.
En el sur de Estados Unidos, donde hay leyes que realmente discriminan a los votantes pobres y negros para que no puedan votar, resulta aún más difícil realizar esta labor de organización.
And the reason why I'm saying this to you in this session is because I know that your party leaders will be reviewing these tapes. And a lot of what happens on the left, a lot of the theoretical discourse around the left and a lot of the critiques of from the left, not just in America but also in Europe, center around why we are not starting a third party. And there's never a real understanding of the structural impediments that stand before us. And so it's very important for Podemos to understand that these structural impediments are real. And it's not that we don't want to start a third party, it's just actually completely impossible now. We can start building toward that. We can start thinking about like how we will do this. And some of those answers lie in the future of municipalism in many of our American cities, because that's a lot easier. You can run as a green, you can run as an independent, you can run as a socialist in cities. But at the federal level, there are serious impediments, and so I just need for your party leadership and your the folks who are around the world who are advising you to understand that it's not that we're not thinking about that, it's just very, very difficult. The Constitution, state by state, actually prevents us from doing this.
Sí, es importante aclarar que dentro de la izquierda, bueno, dentro y fuera de Estados Unidos y a nivel internacional, siempre les plantean o sale la duda de por qué no lanzan un tercer partido que no sean ni los demócratas ni los republicanos. Quiere dejar claro, simplemente constatar que hay una serie de obstáculos institucionales que hacen que sea muy difícil realizar una iniciativa así a nivel federal. Es más fácil hacerlo a nivel municipal, donde se pueden presentar candidaturas de terceros partidos, se puede tener éxito, pero digamos que el grado de obstáculos legales que hay que sortear y de infraestructura que hay que tener para lanzar esto a un tercer partido a nivel federal es abrumador. No es algo que se descarte de cara al futuro, pero no es simplemente un planteamiento que se pueda realizar en un horizonte de 4 años.
Which brings me to what we're actually trying to do right now.
Eso me lleva a lo que tenemos que hacer actualmente.
We have to both simultaneously ignore the Democratic Party and the apparatus, and also try to take over.
Tenemos que al mismo tiempo que ignoramos todo el aparato del Partido Demócrata intentar hacernos con él.
So while this may appear to be a contradiction,
esto parece a primera vista ser una cosa contradictoria,
it's the only possible way that we can win in 2018, ahead of 2020, which is our national elections for president.
Pero es la única forma en que realmente podemos ganar las elecciones legislativas de 2018, que son el trampolín para las presidenciales de 2020.
And the Bernie grassroots, the Bernie social movement that Bernie is a part of, is a movement that is extremely strong in the United States right now. It's not the only movement. There are many, many movements in the United States that are very strong, including the Black Lives Matter movement, the women's movement, the environmental justice movement. These are all social movements that have activists, and you call them militants, who belong to these movements. And we're really at a time right now, we're really in the time of trying to figure out how to bring all of these movements together to create a multiracial, multigenerational, broad popular front.
El movimiento social que ha empezado Bernie, del que Bernie es parte, en realidad, que no sea la cabeza simplemente, es un movimiento que es muy potente, pero que no es el único que está haciendo cambio en Estados Unidos. Hay movimientos en contra de la brutalidad policial, hay movimientos antirracistas, ecologistas, feministas, y uno de los grandes retos de aquí a los años siguientes es aunar todos esos movimientos en una plataforma que sea transversal en temas de, es decir, que sea una agenda anticapitalista, pero también antirracista, pro derechos del medio ambiente, feminista y demás.
And we think that if we can actually get coordinated and build organizational capacity in the same way that Podemos managed to build many, many institutions that are democratic, we'll be able to win.
Creen que si son capaces de organizarse y generar instituciones y organizaciones que les ayuden a competir como hemos hecho nosotros, pueden tener éxito.
And what we learned on the Bernie campaign is that organizing in a big way is the key to building power.
Lo que aprendieron en la campaña de Bernie es que organizar a gran escala es clave para hacerse, para llegar a posiciones de poder.
And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Claire Sandberg.
Thanks. And Winnie, I'm going to ask you to talk about a few of these slides too. But
sure.
I think that some of these images will help to just kind of put a picture to some of the themes that Winnie just talked about of both how we got here and also where we are now in the U.S.
Claire quiere ilustrar con una serie de imágenes, digamos, lo que acaba de presentar Winnie y exponer un poco cómo, cuál es el, la posición de Estados Unidos en base a eso.
So, as Winnie mentioned, People for Bernie was a grassroots movement and is a grassroots movement that really arose organically. There were people, a few people like Winnie, who really had been deeply involved in Occupy Wall Street, other movements who really created the kind of, created a structure to give shape to it. But it was this really amazing organic phenomenon that happened in response to the power of Bernie's message for a political revolution.
Bueno, People for Bernie Sanders, la organización de Winnie, es una organización que nació en gran medida de forma espontánea. Winnie venía del activismo en Occupy y eso ayudó a crear una serie de, bueno, una base organizativa para The People. Pero realmente nació, surgió de forma espontánea y a raíz del entusiasmo que generó la candidatura de Bernie Sanders y la llamada de Bernie Sanders a hacer una revolución política.
So, just to put some context to it, when Bernie Sanders announced he was running for president and he called for a political revolution, he did not expect it to really take off the way that it did. And only 5% of people in the United States had even heard of Bernie Sanders when he launched his campaign in April of 2015.
Sí, en abril de 2015, cuando lanza Bernie su campaña en las primarias demócratas, pide una, hace un llamamiento a una revolución política, pero tampoco pensando que vaya a tener muchísimo tirón. En ese momento solo conoce, solo un 5% del país sabe quién es Bernie Sanders.
And we don't have any rules in the US about giving candidates or political parties equal airtime. So even though the media was just giving wall-to-wall coverage to Donald Trump almost incessantly from the very beginning, the broadcast media barely covered Bernie Sanders at all because they considered him irrelevant.
Sí, en Estados Unidos no hay ningún tipo de reglamento de cuánto tiempo tienen que destinar los grupos mediáticos a cada candidato, ¿no? En la cobertura. Entonces, enseguida los medios se volcaron en cubrir a Trump en cuanto se presentó y a contar todas las barbaridades que hacía y decía, pero a Bernie apenas le daban tiempo, y apenas figuraba ahí.
So, what made Bernie Sanders take off was that the initial people who had heard of him and who responded to his message made him go viral on the internet in a person-to-person way through memes like these. Like Feel the Burn, as Winnie mentioned, and this meme that was shared how many times? Millions of times.
Millions of times. So we actually
Just give me a second, I'm gonna...
Okay.
Lo que dio el primer impulso a la campaña de Bernie fue que la gente que conocía a Bernie y que sabía esta campaña y que estaba entusiasmada, lo popularizó en internet y realmente le convirtió en un fenómeno viral. A través de pues, memes y demás, y se convirtió en, de repente, Bernie estaba en todas partes, sobre todo a nivel de redes sociales.
Yeah, I mean, we knew actually that we had an opportunity to make him a viral household name, and this is, you know, a lot of the reasons why is because a lot of the people in the collective of People for Bernie are people from Occupy Wall Street, so we understood how to use media in a way that would actually challenge the hegemony.
Surgió la oportunidad de eso, convertir a Bernie en un nombre conocido para todos los americanos. Y eso en gran parte tiene que ver con que muchos de los activistas a los que consiguió reunir Bernie con su candidatura venían de Occupy Wall Street y sabían cómo trazar un relato, cómo expandir un relato popularizar una imagen de una manera casi de comunicación contrahegemónica, ¿no?
Because prior to the social movement eruption of 15M, Tahrir Square and Occupy Wall Street, people were using social media platforms in a very different way than they do now. They were using social media to share photos of themselves at their weddings, with their dogs, with their families, and it was not it just was very different. And they also didn't have as many, they just didn't have as many accounts, you know? And so we identified sort of in the wake of 15M and Occupy Wall Street, that all of a sudden people were like looking at images of protest, disruption, brutality by the state, violence against people who were protesting against inequality. And so we thought, interesting, there is an ability for us to co-opt this moment for ourselves.
Sí, 2011 realmente fue un punto de inflexión en la forma en que la gente usaba las redes sociales. Entonces tú usabas el Twitter o Facebook para mi boda, foto de mi perro y demás. Pero a partir de 2011 realmente hay un punto de inflexión en que la gente empieza a usar estas plataformas para organizarse políticamente y además para compartir fotos, pues mira, de un escándalo político, de brutalidad policial. Entonces, ellos pensaron, mira, esto es interesante, aquí tenemos un filón que puede sernos útil en el futuro.
So it was really important for us to start a digital campaign that acted as a narrative intervention.
Así que era importante crear una campaña digital que realmente realizase en la campaña una intervención en términos de narrativa.
And that digital campaign was decentralized, and that is why it's important to start organizing in a big way, but also think about it as distributed, because the term distributed is a better way of building organization around the decentralization.
Era una campaña digital a gran escala, pero que también estaba muy descentralizada. Entonces, digamos que la idea de una campaña distribuida, es la palabra que yo he usado, es clave para entender cómo se puede organizar a escala grande, pero a la vez sin tener un núcleo centralizado.
Yeah, so this is precisely what we were able to do on the Bernie campaign, is that we came up with a hashtag. We knew that the hashtag itself would carry the narrative of Bernie's policies across the platforms on the internet. Knowing that Facebook has 2 billion members, I mean, emails, whatever you want to call them, accounts, people, bots, you know, people who participate, who are on Facebook all day because they have nowhere to go. And Twitter, and so we knew that we had like no choice but to actually use these platforms, and so we created a campaign where there were more than we have more than 100 Facebook accounts that are not dissimilar to the Podemos constituency accounts, but that are probably better organized because we do have these structures that we've put in place.
Bueno, una de las claves fue, digamos, popularizar en redes sociales esta narrativa con el hashtag, esto, Feel the Burn, que quiere decir algo así como, bueno, es un juego de palabras, ¿no? Como siente la llama, pero también es un juego de palabras con el nombre de Bernie. Y Facebook y Twitter eran especialmente importantes para eso, ¿no? Es decir, Facebook, que tenía 2,000 millones de usuarios que están ahí sentados pues, mirándolo todo el día, realmente era una clave para su estrategia.
To give you an example of the meme that you're looking at here, I'm voting for the guy willing to sit in the middle seat. This meme was released at some point, I think maybe like September or October of 2015, right around that time. Bernie launched his campaign in April, and he had already gained significant traction in the country. Not at that point, he hadn't really sort of translated into becoming a global phenomenon yet, but he was very widely known in the United States because media outlets were using the hashtag and some of the other viral memes were being shared widely around the country. But when this meme was shared, on the People for Bernie Facebook page, it became one of the probably the most viral political meme in the history of political memes, which I think the political meme phenomenon really came of age during the Bernie Sanders campaign. And then overnight, people, really literally millions of people around the world saw it and they said, yeah, I am voting for the guy willing to sit in the middle seat, because to them it represented that Bernie is a class warrior.
Sí, digamos que está el meme este de que está Bernie en el asiento en medio como una persona normal, vaya. Fue uno de los contenidos que más éxito tuvo en el nivel de difusión y que ayudó a popularizar un montón su imagen, ¿no? Y además asociarla como con, bueno, una persona normal que hace un mensaje como casi de clase, es decir, no es un político que vive en su burbuja, sino un tío que está ahí en el asiento de en medio del avión.
It just resonated in a very deep way with people around the world who are working class and who are just ordinary people, because as you know, I think we all know, that there are very few people in the world who are wealthy. That's actually the truth.
Sí, la idea de Bernie sentado en el avión, en el asiento este de medio, digamos que de alguna forma resonó con mucha gente de clase trabajadora, de que bueno, es la experiencia que tienen que de ir en un avión, no son políticos, no viajan en primera y al final del día pues muy poca gente tiene esos privilegios en el mundo en que vivimos.
And so it was at this point that we really started scaling our meme production and started really appealing to not just the collectives, the circles. We'll call our People for Bernie constituency groups the collectives of Podemos, right? The circles of Podemos, rather. We really started to appeal to our activists and the people who were really starting to think about like ways that they could support Bernie, be more productive, be more active, be more proactive in the actual campaign itself. It was really at this moment that our team decided that we needed to do something very different, that we really needed to start to scale our ask of people who were already in the country, you know, the 1 or 2 million people at the time who were starting already to populate our Facebook page. We could see the data. We could see that like we were growing very quickly. We could see that we had reached 100,000 likes on Facebook. And we started saying, you know what, we actually have to start doing things differently now. We need to get them to produce for us instead. We need to make this much more distributed. And at the time, the campaign had hired Claire, and she was building structures to try to capture a lot of the energy, a lot of the people who were like, oh my God, this guy is amazing. He's sitting in the middle seat. Oh my God, look at this GIF. Move to the second slide, you know, and we were starting to make like real intense like political propaganda against the opposition, which at the time, of course, during a primary season is Hillary Clinton and not, you know, the Republican candidate.
A partir de ahí fue cuando se dieron cuenta que, bueno, tenemos que hacer algo más que simplemente mandar contenido y memes a la, digamos, el equivalente a nuestros círculos, ¿no? De los pequeños grupos activistas, sino realmente convertirlos a ellos en productores de contenido para tener un alcance muchísimo mayor. Y esto se juntó con el momento en que Claire estaba empezando a llevar la campaña al tema digital, es decir, cómo podemos desde la campaña realmente hacer uso de toda esta energía que se está generando en torno a pues este contenido.
And this just went on for like ever. I mean, it was like the amount of meme production from the people was, I mean, you could be in here for hours like scrolling through all the Bernie content, and many of you saw it in Spain. You know, you saw the videos, you saw the GIFs, you saw the images, and you were like, what the fuck is going on in America, right? And that went on for a long time, and then people around the world started saying, Bernie Sanders is amazing. This is great. Like, something is happening in America. Hillary Clinton is the worst. And we were very, from the sort of central command, we'll call it headquarters, People for Bernie, we always had an editorial process in place and a scope of what we wanted to share. We actually weren't chaotic in the messaging. We always controlled the messaging and the narrative very tightly on the inside.
Sí, desde, digamos, el centro de mando de su organización, a nivel editorial, tiene mucho cuidado, a pesar de todo, de cuál es la línea que queremos seguir y cómo son los contenidos que queremos publicar ahora. Y bueno, digamos que esto llevó a que el fenómeno fuese creciendo más allá de Estados Unidos, donde realmente en países como España la gente está empezando a decir, oye, ¿quién es este tío? El socialista, Bernie y tal.
And I think this was this is a very important thing to share, because I think that, like, for those of you who are reviewing the tapes, you'll look at this and say, well, that could be a little bit dangerous, and that might not work. And certainly on the inside of the campaign, they were like, Jesus Christ, like, this is so dangerous and so weird and terrible, and, like, bad things are going to happen. But the reality is, bad things did not happen. And I knew that bad things would not happen because we were actually controlling the messaging and the narrative. We knew that, like, they would come back to us and ask us, well, what should we write about? Like, what should we do? Because we were also creating content of our own, and our content was branded in the same way that Podemos content is branded. But we knew that if we didn't rely on the grassroots and just people in the world to produce and replicate these ideas, because a meme is an idea that replicates and scales, right, throughout the world. And so we knew that if we didn't rely on people to do this critical work, it would be less creative, less participatory, and that it wouldn't actually feel authentic, and that it would feel sterile and almost like, you know, clinical and boring.
Sí, digamos que los memes y los contenidos virales, por su propia naturaleza, la distribución es descentralizada y tienes que depender de gente que los vaya a ir pasando y que no están bajo tu control, sino que son ellos los que editan los contenidos como quieren. Esto en su momento generó bastante escepticismo entre otra gente que llevaba las campañas de manera más tradicional, decir, no, esto no va a funcionar, esto va a salir fatal. No ocurrió así, también en parte porque ellas, el contenido que diseñaban, es verdad que pasaba por un proceso bastante cuidadoso de realmente selección y de distribución.
And so while this was all going on, the campaign was watching us, thinking, we have to do something, we have to figure out how to receive all of this energy, all of these eyeballs, all of these people wanting to support Bernie Sanders, and how do we do that? And so the campaign had an incredible team of organizers led by Claire, and a couple of our other friends who are also doing very important work in America now. And they built these structures inside the campaign to receive people. And what we then started to do was we started to build a pipeline where people would first come to one of the social media destinations. There were hundreds of them, right? And then we would curate a piece of content or launch a campaign, get them to stay compelled, stay drawn in, and then we would move them into a map that was developed by a volunteer coder who started something called Coders for Sanders. And the map was called map.BernieSanders. So every time you would come in to Facebook and see another amazing, hilarious meme or an amazing, hilarious GIF or a video showing that Hillary Clinton took, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars from a bank to tell them that she would, you know, never send them to jail. We would make these videos and people would be like, oh my God, Hillary is the worst. But then they wouldn't know where to go. And then we would send them to a map that was created by one of our volunteers. And the map was used by the official campaign to get them to give them information, right? Their phone number, their email, and all sorts of things. And then in that map, many things started to happen, and I'm going to turn this back over to Claire because she's going to talk a little bit about, like, where they went after they got to the map.
Sí, la campaña tenía el dilema de decir, vale, está genial todo este entusiasmo en las redes, pero ¿cómo realmente lo convertimos esto en algo que tenga un significado a nivel electoral? Winnie gestionaba cientos de cuentas, un poco como hace Podemos, pero de ahí, ¿cómo haces tú para que esas cuentas realmente la gente, vale, si ve un meme, ve algo que le hace gracia, no sé qué, se lo manda a sus amigos, ¿cómo consigues que se genere un activismo o una implicación más allá de eso? Parte de lo que hicieron fue que un diseñador, bueno, de coder, sí,
okay, cool.
un diseñador de código, les hizo un mapa de Estados Unidos en el que, bueno, tú te metías a mirar en la página de Facebook vídeos de tal virales de Bernie o de, no sé, una información de Hillary Clinton, no sé qué, y además luego te ofrecían el mapa, decir, vale, cuál es tu dirección, si te interesa contribuir, cómo puedes hacerlo, para que me manden un email o lo que sea.
Yeah, so while Winnie and People for Bernie were creating all of these different voices, and while all of these volunteers were creating this grassroots creative content that was diverse and funny and interesting, there were all of these people who were saying, who were standing up and saying, yes, I want to be a part of this movement, what do I do? And so on the campaign, we had to think about what to ask them to do.
Sí, es decir, claro, la gente se entusiasmaba, pero luego tenía la cuestión de, vale, ¿y yo qué puedo hacer para ayudar? Y desde el punto de vista de la campaña también era un reto decir, vale, realmente, ¿qué podemos hacer con tanta gente? ¿Qué tipo de funciones les podemos asignar?
And the American primary system, presidential primary system, means that we have all of these, we have each state voting by itself with a certain number of delegates, and there's a count, it takes place over many months where each state, there are a number of states that go first, and then we have more and more and more. And so because of the way that that you can fight to win the Democratic nomination, we had to organize in those states to reach out to the people who were not on the internet, because there were some people who were seeing all of these memes, but then there were the vast majority of voters in some places, older voters especially, in some of those important states might not have still even heard of Bernie Sanders.
Sí, como sabéis, el proceso de primarias en Estados Unidos es muy largo, empiezan una serie de estados, luego va progresando, es un proceso que dura meses y en el que hay que competir en áreas muy diferentes, algunas son urbanas, otras son rurales. Eso les planteaba el problema de, vale, está muy bien Bernie lo peta en internet, pero ¿cómo hacemos cuando vamos a un estado rural o donde la gente es mayor y a lo mejor no tiene acceso a internet o no conoce a Bernie porque no está en Twitter, ¿no? ¿Y cómo llegamos a esa gente que no es nuestro público, el público al que en primer lugar hemos llegado?
So, in a traditional American electoral campaign, you would just hire hundreds or even thousands of paid staff members who would do work managing volunteers to get out and talk to every single voter in a key state. But we didn't have that money, and it also would not have been reflective of the grassroots viral nature of the campaign to do it in that traditional way.
En una campaña normal en Estados Unidos, lo que haces es que contratas a cientos o incluso miles de organizadores que a la vez van subdelegando voluntarios para llamar a cada puerta y contarles pues la historia del candidato, ¿no? Pero la campaña de Bernie ni tenía el dinero para hacer eso ni tampoco encajaba con su filosofía de activismo de base, pues eso, pagar a 1,000 personas para que estén llevando mi mensaje.
So what we realized was that we could, instead of paying staff, instead of hiring all of these staff, we could actually empower the volunteers to do the work. And we did that, the biggest way that we did that was through this map, by asking people to host events. We didn't ask them to be in charge of their regions, because you can't put one person in charge of all of Cleveland. It doesn't work. There's no way to manage that level of complexity. But what you can do is you can invite anyone, anywhere, to host an event, and then invite other people to come to that event and use that as the engine of doing all of the work.
Una de las formas de hacer esto, en vez de hacerlo vertical, decir yo contrato al profesional que me gestiona a los activistas, era al revés, a través de la herramienta esta, el mapa que diseñaron, que la gente que estuviese interesada en participar en la campaña se metiese en el mapa y decir, vale, vivo, pues yo qué sé, en Boston, ¿qué es lo que puedo hacer en mi área para que puedo montar una reunión con más gente que sean simpatizantes o que quieran, sean activistas, para organizar un evento de pro Bernie Sanders? No es lo mismo que decirle a una persona, pues tú te haces cargo de todo el estado. Es decir, no funcionaba a ese nivel macro, pero funcionaba a nivel local, de organizar pues en tu barrio a los demás activistas que estaban interesados.
So this image of the map is just from one day. This is actually showing all of the, we had 4,000 events when we did our organizing kickoff in July of 2015, we asked volunteers to host events, and Bernie Sanders gave a live speech to all of these events. Over 100,000 people watched it. And we invited all of these people who were near them, many of whom they didn't know. They were just people who lived near them who wanted to get involved, to come to their houses and participate.
El primer evento de este tipo a escala nacional fue en julio de 2015 y hubo, estáis viendo en el mapa todos los eventos que hubo a la vez, 4.000 en el país, y de hecho Bernie Sanders apareció en... So he appeared online, on streaming? Or?
Yeah, a live stream.
Sí. Pues, Bernie hizo un live stream de forma que toda la gente que había montado el evento vio a Bernie Sanders en el salón de su casa dirigiéndose a ellos y la asistencia total fue de 100.000 personas interesadas. 100.000, right?
100,000 people and 4,000 events. Yeah. And then over the course of the campaign, we kept doing this. So we ended up having over 80,000 events run by volunteers without staff people running those events in the course of the campaign.
In the entire campaign,
80,000.
Esto se convirtió en un, digamos que una vez que esta estructura estaba en lugar, era cuestión de ir replicándola y a lo largo de la campaña tuvieron lugar, se organizaron 80,000 reuniones de este tipo.
And that was important because that allowed us to, and the types of events I'll talk about in a second, but it allowed us to tell people, here's the most important thing to do right now. You know, the most important thing to do right now is to hold a debate watch party and invite people who don't know about Bernie to come and watch him debate Hillary. Or then later it was, the most important thing is to make phone calls to voters in Iowa or New Hampshire. Or the most important thing is to host a canvas and knock on doors in your community. Whatever the most important thing was, we could tell them what it was and then they would put it on the map.
Sí, el formato tenía una flexibilidad enorme en el sentido de que les permitía a ellas decir, bueno, se han montado los eventos, ese mismo día les podemos decir, ¿qué es lo más importante para que hagáis hoy? A lo mejor es que va a haber un debate demócrata y deberíais invitar amigos, tal, incluso gente que no está convencida para verlo. A lo mejor lo que es importante en este momento de la campaña es hacer llamadas telefónicas para que salga más gente a votar. Pero que digamos que el día a día tenían la opción de a gente a nivel nacional coordinarles y decir, lo más importante hoy es esto.
And the key thing about this that I just want to emphasize is that it allowed everything to scale. Because if we had said, okay, everyone in Boston has to join one group, well then there were tens of thousands of people in Boston who wanted to get involved, and you can't put one volunteer in charge. And then there were thousands of cities around the country, and we couldn't, as a very small staff, manage all of those volunteers. So instead, we asked them not to join a group, but to do a thing, and then to do another thing, and then to do another thing. And then we would just keep telling them, here's the thing we need you to do right now.
Sí, es decir, que la idea de grupos pequeños que montan un evento, en vez de integrarse en una estructura, era muy útil, porque en un país como Estados Unidos, donde hay miles de ciudades, o a lo mejor en Boston tienes a 10.000 voluntarios, y ¿qué vas a hacer? ¿Nombrar a uno que tiene que llevar la voz cantante? Eso, bueno, es más difícil de gestionar que simplemente con grupos pequeños y decir, mira, nos viene bien que hagáis esto ahora, esto otro. Y la gente siente que puede participar más, pero sin tener que integrarse en una organización muy grande y muy difícil de coordinar.
And the key thing about this that allowed it to work was that all of the volunteers understood the strategy. We had an open source strategy. The strategy was not something that only a handful of leaders on the campaign knew. Every single volunteer had to be able to explain our plan to win to other volunteers and recruit them to participate.
Una de los puntos más importantes es que realmente la estrategia de campaña estaba en abierto, de forma que los propios activistas sabían cuál era la estrategia de la campaña y la podían explicar perfectamente. O sea, no era una cuestión simplemente de que les gustase el candidato, sino que realmente tenían interiorizada cuál era el plan para conseguir que ganase.
So these are just some pictures of some of the events of volunteers doing this. And then what was amazing about this is that having an open source strategy also allowed the organic internet movement to recruit people into the campaign to do the work. So people could get creative with it. Just like they were creative with memes, they could be creative with their events. So here are the nurses making phone calls. So this is the organization Winnie works for. This is like a Winnie slide. The organization Winnie works for, making calls. And then you also had Occupy Wall Street making phone calls from Liberty Square.
This is very interesting. Sorry. I forget. Yeah, I'm American. I assume everybody has to speak English.
una de las ventajas es que permitía integrar de manera muy orgánica diferentes grupos dentro de la campaña, es decir, trabajar con este sindicato de enfermeras, que hace una labor estupenda, o con la gente de Occupy, para que ellos, sabiendo cuál era la estrategia de campaña, aportasen lo que más podían dar de forma prácticamente orgánica. Les permitía a la campaña pues, captar mucho talento y ya integrado en una estrategia.
So this takes us, this slide, I know the timeline really well, like I can take a look at a photo and be like, oh, I know when this happened. This happened like in the beginning of the year of 2016. The campaign had already created these structures for us. They had a program in place that was a dialer, right? Like a phone bank. Like you could, they created literally a new platform, a new technology platform where you could just dial and you could dial the numbers of voters' numbers. We had to pay for the voter file. You don't necessarily have that here, and that's not going to be a thing for you, but we're just giving you an illustration of how we got people to do things rather than join a group.
Esto es de a principios de 2016 y es una de las cosas que hacíamos es que tienen un software que, bueno, en España yo creo que no existe de la misma forma. Básicamente es una base de datos con números de teléfono, tú te lo instalas en el ordenador, lo pones en el ordenador y el ordenador empieza a llamar a votantes. Entonces tú le dices, oye, que Bernie, que si te interesa votar a Bernie y tal. Entonces, bueno, yo lo uso unas cuantas veces como funciona. Tú puedes montar el evento, la gente venía a tu casa y decías, se encendía, this is where you saw the map and you could choose what state was most important. Decían, vale, si te llegabas y veías el mapa de Estados Unidos, ¿qué estados van a tener la primaria dentro de poco? ¿En cuáles te decían? Es muy importante que hagamos llamadas en este. Entonces, venga, pues todos a llamar, yo qué sé, en Ohio. Pues a llamar a Ohio.
There were multiple destinations that you could go to on the internet that would tell you to go do something. And that really is why the Bernie campaign was so completely, staggeringly, game-changingly successful. Because you could go to People for Bernie, and we would share, like, an event and say, go do something at that event, right? And or you could go to BernieSanders.com and there would be a list of events that you could participate at. Or you could create your own event. That was another thing that was really phenomenal about the Bernie campaign. BernieSanders.com, if you wanted to host your own phone bank and you wanted people to come, you could say, I'm from the Nurses Union and I'm running a phone bank at our headquarters in Oakland and we want you to come. And here is your event invitation. And people would go to BernieSanders.com and look at the event and say, you know what, I'm going to RSVP. And there was just a constant intake and a constant output. And the output was always a call to action to do something, right? And so while all of this was happening, we were creating on the outside massive propaganda, right? Yeah. Like the love for Bernie Sanders was at an absolute fever pitch all around the country and all around the world. And everybody was like, we have to do something. We are going to do something. And people just started taking initiative. And that's very important. You do have to create a campaign and then you have to operationalize it. And this is the thing that we did really well, was that we would create a campaign. You know, in the case of Podemos, your most recent campaign was massively compelling and extremely successful. Trauma Bus, right? We watched it, I saw it, and I thought, this is amazing. You didn't really operationalize it, and you should. And next time you will, and that's why we're here. To talk about why it's critical to operationalize.
Okay, I'm here to translate, and I
sorry.
I'm not gonna forget. a ver si me acuerdo. Digamos que en la campaña se generó un círculo virtuoso, es decir, por la absorción de toda esta gente que estaba, haciendo las llamadas del phone banking, aportando desde su organización algo en lo que podían contribuir, pero también de a la vez sacarlo otra vez afuera y movilizar a la gente. Pues hace falta llamar más, hace falta tal. El mapa es verdad que esa herramienta era muy útil en el sentido que te dirigía automáticamente y te daba algo que hacer si querías ser útil y que era fácil. Los eventos de las llamadas los podías montar en tu casa. O sea, tú ibas y te registrabas, montabas un evento y venían los voluntarios a casa y con un par de ordenadores te daba para hacer las llamadas. Aunque no todas las técnicas son iguales, la idea es muchas de estas técnicas poder aplicarlas aquí. Winnie estaba diciendo que, por ejemplo, la campaña del Tramabús le gustó mucho, la idea le parece muy buena, pero que no llegamos a operacionalizarla hasta a sacarle el máximo rendimiento que le podríamos haber dado.
Yeah, and so again, just on Winnie's point about the tools and about this, so having both the open source strategy, everyone understands why they're doing what you're asking them to do. And then open source tools, so the map, the phone calling system, our texting system, all of these things, the openness of them, of both the strategy and the tools, allowed people to get creative and for us to not limit the amount of activity they would do. So then you had things like this. You had memes encouraging people to phone bank. You had volunteers making 1,000 phone calls a day. Volunteers made 85 million phone calls.
85 million.
85 million phone calls and sent 10 million text messages over the course of the campaign because we just gave them the tools and we explained to them why it was important.
Yeah. Las cifras las sabéis, ¿no? 85 millones de llamadas y 10 million text messages.
And 85 million phone calls.
Sí, 85 millones de llamadas y 10 millones de mensajes de texto. Eso es lo que se consiguió llevar a cabo con esta iniciativa. Y Claire insiste en que parte de ello tenía que ver con... O sea, una de las grandes ventajas era que era muy abierto y era transparente. Entonces la gente tenía una idea muy clara de qué estaba haciendo y por qué.
Yeah. And so... sorry.
We've got like 10, 15 more minutes.
Okay,
is that good?
And you have to go. Okay. So to give you an idea of the scale of this, while this was all happening on the outside, People for Bernie... We were experiencing incredible viral growth on social media. We didn't even know what was going on. We, over the course of the year and a half, we reached 4.6 billion timelines around the world. 4.6 billion actual timelines. The content was just being pushed out and pushed out and pushed out. And at every point, we were saying, if you don't phone bank, you're dead to us. You know, get on those dialers. Like, every piece of content was just like, you're a loser if you don't get on the phones, you know? Like, you want us to die? Like, I mean, it was like a constant, like, I mean, we didn't say that, but we sort of did. We sort of did. Did we? Like, we sort of did. Yeah, like, you're going to die. Like, you are the worst person in the world for, like, not supporting. Hillary Clinton is the worst person in the world, and if you don't want her to be president, you need to get on those phones right now. And so it was constant. And then we were branching out into Instagram. Right, like in January, Instagram just exploded, and we were using Instagram, and we were making like short, like incredible videos for Instagram specifically to get the kids involved. And kids are on their phones all day long, like. And if you don't draw kids in with like lighthearted, funny, like funny messaging, they won't participate. And so it was precisely in that moment that we actually started moving into a much more radical direction, and at the time the campaign just didn't care anymore. They were completely working with us because they knew that they had to. They couldn't censor us. They were like, forget it, like we have to just do this. And so it really was pretty extraordinary. It was an extraordinary time.
Digamos que a partir de enero de 2016 despegó, sobre todo en People for Bernie Sanders, que realmente la actividad que están teniendo online despegó totalmente, llegaron a estar en 4.600 millones de timelines y también cambiaron la estrategia de comunicación a un poco más de, jaja, no solo el meme está gracioso, sino que sí, te ha hecho gracia, pero además tienes que hacer algo en la campaña o digamos que meter un poco la inquietud de, oye, que necesitamos que nos ayudes, que necesitamos que hagas tal, que hagas cual, que como no lo estés haciendo, en el fondo nos da igual que te rías con nuestro contenido. También una de las cosas que les funcionó bien en ese momento fue usar cosas como Instagram a partir de 2016 y todo un poco basado en la idea de que si quieres activar a votantes que son jóvenes y demás, tienes que darles pues algo que sea pues de fácil de consumir y divertido y que les llame la atención, les parezca interesante y les entretenga.
Yeah, and then so Winnie talked about, so I'm now going to show some slides from what Winnie talked about with where we are now, which was just provide some visuals for that. We're actively in a fight for hegemony at this point. We lost, obviously, and it's really important to say this when he says this all the time, but we lost, you know, and we're sorry that we lost.
Yeah. She lost. They lost. I'll never be with her, ever.
We came further than anyone thought we could, and we had a really uphill battle, and now we're in the bigger fight, which is the fight for hegemony.
Con todo esto es importante admitir que, bueno, a pesar de todo, Bernie perdió las primarias, las perdió por muy poco, ¿no? ¿Cuántos? How many? 24 states, 22 states. How many states did Bernie win?
I don't remember.
15.
Yeah. 15, bueno, sí, vamos, que, o sea, las primarias, Bernie las perdió a pesar de todo, aunque con un resultado mucho mejor de lo esperado, pero que es importante tener en cuenta que al final las perdió, aunque también porque tenía todo el aparato demócrata en contra.
Yeah.
Y que ahora, digamos, lo que están haciendo es una lucha por la hegemonía dentro del propio Partido Demócrata, ¿no? Con sus instituciones de reproducción de contenidos, pues think tanks, fundaciones, los brazos mediáticos del partido que también son potentes.
Yep. So we don't have a lot of time left because he has to go someplace else, so I want to do this really quickly, and I don't want to spend too much time getting in the weeds here. This think tank is Hillary's think tank. They are the people who are who continue to raise money from the corporations, from the 1%. They take money to basically do nothing. They are the neoliberals. And sí. The neoliberals are the real reason why the democracy is in such crisis.
Sí, este es el Center for American Progress. Es una fundación como podría haber sido aquí la Fundación Ideas antes de que... Es, digamos, el think tank del Partido Demócrata, ¿no? Es su fundación principal y, bueno, en teoría son los que quieren presentar una cara amable del neoliberalismo, pero, bueno, luego su agenda es absolutamente, vendida. Aceptan donaciones multimillonarias, defienden una política exterior muy agresiva para Estados Unidos y demás. Pero es el gran think tank del Partido Demócrata. Entonces, esta es la gente con la que hay que... a la que hay que desplazar y con la que hay que trabajar al mismo tiempo.
And the Bernie people are fighting for hegemony right now, and we're doing a really, really good job, okay? So the nurses' union are the people that I work for, and they are also the union, the trade union, that supports Bernie and the left economic plan.
Sí, uno de los apoyos más importantes que tiene Bernie Sanders y con quien trabaja Winnie es con el sindicato de enfermeras de Estados Unidos, que es un sindicato que... Bueno, hace una labor muy importante en varios frentes. Siempre está como punta de lanza en todo lo que es reivindicar sanidad universal y demás, pero además se mete en muchas cuestiones de promover una agenda progresista más allá de simplemente su interés laboral.
So CAP had a conference where they had a lot of the 2020 potential 2020 presidential candidates and a lot of very wealthy donors who were in attendance. You had to pay $1,000 to attend, and it was at a 5-star hotel, and it was a complete failure.
Sí, un ejemplo de cómo funciona el mainstream demócrata. Organizaron una especie de gran conferencia para un poco ver quiénes eran los candidatos demócratas de cara a 2020, y el evento lo celebraron en un hotel de 5 estrellas, costaba 1,000 pavos ir, entonces, este es un poco el formato, no es una cosa en absoluto inclusiva.
Shortly after the CAP conference, we had the People Summit, which was a monumental success and attracted, the media attention of international media. We had media from Asia in attendance. We had media from South Africa in attendance. And so it was a really phenomenal event. And what we did was we centered every high-profile social movement activist, every single important high-profile social movement activist, including thinkers, academics, luminaries, and institutional leaders into one space, and we programmed a political education conference that was rooted, that is rooted in ideological thinking.
How many people?
4,400.
Yeah. 4,400. Sí, la respuesta fue, Winnie junto con el sindicato de enfermeras montaron el People Summit en Chicago, que fue, un formato un poco similar al de la Universidad de Verano, pero también, relanzar la figura de Bernie con muchas asociaciones que la han apoyado, no solo el mundo laboral, sino activistas, medios de comunicación. Bueno, en realidad fue un éxito, fueron 4,400 personas y tuvo una cobertura mediática enorme. Y sirvió para un poco presentar la figura de Bernie como una figura que está trabajando con el Partido Demócrata, pero que es independiente y tiene una agenda propia. Y una serie de grupos de apoyo de gente que no necesariamente le guarda ningún cariño al Partido Demócrata.
And so we own the popular we own the narrative now. We definitely won this fight. We absolutely have won the narrative battle. We've won the fight for the narrative, and they will not be able to take it back from us, no matter how much they try, because we're at a place now where even the mainstream media are saying, Bernie would have won, Bernie can still win, and we should listen to them, and the Democratic Party should listen to these people, and all of their organizers and their operatives should be brought in to help us, because if we don't, we will lose, and then the world will descend into complete dystopia and chaos. Sí. Even the media are saying that now.
Esto es algo que, en realidad, esto que os estamos contando ha ocurrido en los últimos 2 meses y realmente ha sido un éxito en términos narrativos de recentrar la figura de Bernie, pero además plantear realmente la cuestión de que si Bernie hubiese ganado contra Trump, ¿no? Esta es la idea. Y que, realmente si quieres parar a lo que representa Trump, no te basta con una candidata que representa el status quo y que simplemente te venda que no es horrorosa para que la gente salga y vote, ¿no? Y esto ha servido para que dentro de incluso la propia prensa, Bernie Sanders ya se ha percibido no solo como, bueno, como antes era como, bueno, el candidato así más a la izquierda en el partido, pero como una figura un poco marginal, a que realmente sea considerado como uno de los principales, de las principales figuras del partido y sobre todo una figura muy importante de cara a 2020.
So our challenge now is to see whether or not we can build democratic organization, and with that advance as a formation toward the Democratic Party apparatus and take power, take control of the levers. And then once we have those levers, we can start electing true progressive candidates to win in our House, in our Congress, in all of our state legislatures and in our municipal offices.
Sí, el reto ahora es, digamos, apuntar a lo que es el aparato del Partido Demócrata y ser capaz de entrar en él y desplazar a la gente que lo lleva ahora mismo para, de cara a la siguiente, a las elecciones legislativas, que son en 2018, realmente poder presentar un abanico de candidatos que sean claramente progresistas.
And none of this is possible if we don't stay true to the principles of big organizing. We cannot afford, we don't have the money, we don't have the people, we don't have the manpower to hire people to make the political revolution a reality. We need to continue to utilize this method of big organizing by empowering people to participate in the political revolution. We need to make sure in America that people are producing opinion, they're producing actions, they're productive, they're taking proactive steps to create another world. Otherwise, we will never ever get there, and we know this now. And so we aren't stopping. Nothing, the Bernie people have not stopped. We have not paused for even 1 minute. I do not sleep, like, at all. Claire sleeps a little bit more than me, but Claire's been in England, I've been in England. All over the world, we are seeing people adopt these methodologies. You know, even the Mélenchon campaign had a lot of Bernie Sanders volunteers on their campaign. Those people who traveled to France learned how we did it, went back to France, and then they did this this very quick and dirty intervention, and then he won 6 million votes. And if that socialist had conceded, if Hamon had conceded, Mélenchon would have won. And so we know that big organizing techniques and methodologies can work, and we need to continue to organize all of our campaigns utilizing that that formula. And we hope that those of you in Podemos understand this, and we are by no means trying to tell you how to do things. We just have the tools, and we want to share the tools with you. And hopefully this session will be informative for your policy people and for your leadership to sort of review and think about, like, what you need to do to create, what kind of cultural campaign you need to create, what kind of political campaign you need to create, right? And then when you have questions about the actual technique, you let us know and we will come back and we will help you develop it.
Sí, digamos que nada de lo que se están planteando hacer en Estados Unidos es posible usando las técnicas que se usan tradicionalmente en Estados Unidos. O sea, no tienen ni el dinero ni a la gente para lanzarse a hacer las cosas como se haría tradicionalmente. Tienen que seguir con los principios que han estado desarrollando en la campaña de Bernie de organización a gran escala. Y esto es algo que ellas dos están, además, les está siendo muy útil no solo en Estados Unidos, sino fuera. Es decir, Claire y Winian está ahora en Reino Unido, donde también estas técnicas fueron bastante útiles en la campaña de Corbyn. Mélenchon también contó con gente de Bernie Sanders, gente que fue de Francia a Estados Unidos, luego volvió para intentar centrar su campaña y traer algunos de los temas que habían usado en Estados Unidos y aplicarlos ahí. Y bueno, fue un éxito en la medida en que, digamos, el aumento del voto de Mélenchon en las últimas semanas, que no era esperado. Y que lo que esperan es que estas técnicas nos puedan ser útiles también a nosotros. Que no lo dice porque nos pretenda decir qué es lo que tenemos que hacer y soltarnos aquí las instrucciones, sino al revés, que son unas técnicas que pueden ser muy útiles y nos pueden ayudar a ser más creativos y a pues tener un alcance mayor.
Claire.
Just the only final thing, if you're following what's happening in the US right now, you may have noticed that the biggest fight for us at this moment is healthcare, because healthcare was the biggest thing that Obama put his political legacy on, and it didn't go far enough. He passed a health care bill that left many people uninsured, but did provide health care to some people, and now Donald Trump is trying to dismantle it. So there's a fight right now where Bernie Sanders is actually the person who is, more than any other politician, leading the way to fight Trump care. And at the same time, pushing for universal health care, which is the thing that the establishment Democratic Party doesn't want to do. So the only final point is just that increasingly Bernie Sanders is winning the narrative by defining the antagonism, because the establishment Democrats actually have no vision to compete with Donald Trump's vision. So it's increasingly Bernie's vision versus Trump's vision is the conflict in our politics right now.
And I want to just say one last thing. The establishment Democrats have no vision because they are the puppets of the ruling class. And that needs to be very, very clear. These people are in the pockets of the multinational corporations. They are pro-business Democrats. And this cannot be the case. They must all go. And we have to organize them out, and we are doing that.
Bueno, volviendo para cerrar al tema de Estados Unidos, comentaba Claire que ahora mismo en Estados Unidos la gran batalla es por la sanidad. Bueno, Obama, sabéis, pasó una reforma sanitaria que en realidad era bastante defectuosa, dejó como a 30 millones de personas sin cobertura sanitaria, pero ahora Trump está pasando una que es aún peor, que básicamente va a dejar a 50 millones de personas expuestas a ningún tipo de sanidad pública. Y en ese contexto, Bernie está sabiendo muy bien polarizar el debate entre lo que está haciendo Trump y lo que él propone, que es un sistema de sanidad pública como tiene cualquier país europeo, que en Estados Unidos no existe y aún se considera como una cosa utópica que es muy difícil de alcanzar. Eso le ha funcionado muy bien porque está realmente polarizando el debate, es decir, que si la reforma de Obama, bueno, era un poquito mejor, pero a nadie le entusiasmaba, y lo que Sanders propone gusta y lo que Trump propone es tremendamente impopular, realmente las dos opciones que se están perfilando son esos dos extremos, Sanders o Trump. Y ahí el establishment demócrata no tiene ningún mensaje, porque, y es lo que comentaban Claire y Winnie al final, es gente que realmente no tiene una especie de proyecto de país, más allá de, bueno, gestionar las cosas un poco tal y como están y tener la fiesta en paz, con algún guiño un poco de una política mínimamente humana, pero sin hacer gran cosa. Y el establishment demócrata no tiene nada que hacer en esa coyuntura y no se plantea abrazar la sanidad universal. Entonces se están revelando como que al final del día es gente que se debe al status quo y que no pretende cambiar nada. Y gente a la que hay que echar, en resumen, que es lo que ha dicho Winnie. Y a la que van a echar.
We want you to win. We cannot win without you. And we're going to win this together.
Quieren que ganemos, no pueden ganar sin nosotros y vamos a ganar todos juntos.
All right, we have to get out of the room because she's mad at us.